Welcome to the Sustainable Development E-Talk series, co-hosted by CNS and Indian Institute of Management, Indore. We are indeed honored to have with us today Dr. Ishwar Gilada, the longest-serving HIV medical expert in the country. He is a living chronicle of India's fight to end AIDS over the past almost 35 years now. He will share his reflections on the journey to end AIDS since the first case got diagnosed in India.
Good afternoon, sir. I am Indore, extends a hearty welcome to you. We are grateful that you could join us on this platform today, and we look forward to your enriching talk. Thank you, and over to you, Dr. Gilada.
Good afternoon. It's my pleasure to be here during this lockdown in the country, and probably this is the best way to interact with people. There are no personal visits available, no personal conferences available. What I'm going to deal with in the next 50 minutes or so is journey to end AIDS. And I happen to start India's first HIV awareness campaign. That was in 1985, and to be precise, it was September 1985 when I started HIV awareness. And at that time, there was not a single diagnosed case in the country anywhere. May I have my next slide? So, okay. So this is over the years, and next slide. I just wanted to show how things changed from going with the garland of condom to the soup group wala particular. So what I was talking about is September 1985. I happened to be in one of the conferences in Ireland. That was not HIV conference, that was a health education conference. It was from 11th to 15th of September. And during that conference, one of the speakers there was a workshop on HIV AIDS. So I was following up on HIV AIDS in newspapers, in scientific journals from 81, that some new disease has come. But like everybody else in the country, I used to also think that it may not be in our country. So just keep a watch and keep all the press clippings and scientific articles ready. If and when it comes, that we have some material ready with us. So during that workshop in Ireland, Dublin, that scientist said that AIDS is not only a problem of Europe and America. The patients of HIV AIDS may be dying in countries like Africa or India. When he spoke about India, I felt a little bit humiliated because I thought I'm so well informed, and he's talking that HIV may be also in India. So I raised my hand, and when I had an interaction with him in a kind of question and answer session, I said, how can you speak that it could be in India? So he said, young man, just go back to your country and talk to your doctors. You'll realize that many of them may not know about HIV/AIDS. So after that little interaction, I felt bad, but I came back in India. And within 1 week, we did a survey of about 200 doctors, 100 from government and 100 from private sector. And we asked very, very basic questions. What is long form of HIV? What is long form of AIDS? Whether India could be having AIDS or not. To my dismay, 90% of doctors did not know the long form of AIDS or HIV. And I said, if they do not know even the long form of the infection or the disease, how will they know about HIV/AIDS? So we launched HIV awareness campaign within 1 week after that. And that was 28th of or 29th of September, we had a press conference. And that was widely covered next day, that AIDS could be already in India, but people may not be aware. So rather than appreciate it, because I thought, now news has come in this report, people will appreciate, they will say that you have been so innovative, you have taken some lead. Rather than that, people started abusing me, particularly from my own medical community, and also my superior dean and director talking to me that what nonsense you are talking. You are not doing your work properly, you are talking about AIDS and this and that. AIDS will not come to this country for next 10 or 20 years. We have family system, we have marriage system. So once, twice, thrice, I said, okay, fine, sir, okay, I'll consider, I'll look at it. But finally, when I got so many calls, I said, I have taken a public stand. If you have guts, you refute me publicly. Why you are abusing me privately? And thereafter, they kept quiet. Next slide. So, the first HIV clinic was started in Mumbai, and that was on 5th of March 1986 that inauguration was done. But what has happened? After the news came in newspaper everywhere, it was also published in Time magazine. And after reading, Time magazine quoted me and Government of India Health Secretary Mr. D.B. Bish. D.B. Bish said that there is nothing like AIDS in India, and if we try to concentrate on something which is non-existent, our high priority program will suffer. And I said that this is a head in the sand attitude, and there has been a saying in our surgery that eyes do not see what the mind does not know. So if we do not know what is HIV look like, we are not likely to diagnose them and we'll miss these cases. And after that, one of the Abbott laboratory person from Hong Kong, he read that news in Time magazine. He called me. Those days there were no mobile phones. He called me on landline and he said, Dr. Gilada, I would like to come and see you in Mumbai. So I said, most welcome. He came and he said that you are a community person. There is nobody in the country who is talking about HIV AIDS. If we offer you a test, will you be able to run the test? I said, yes, but I work in government. I need to take government permission. So he has given me a letter of offer. And with that letter of offer, I went to the Health Minister of Government of Maharashtra because I worked in Government of Maharashtra at that time. And with that letter, Government of Maharashtra Health Minister, he said that it's not only testing, you require to set up a department or a clinic. So I said, yes, that's what we would like to do. And that clinic will have a function of HIV awareness in the high-risk community, which are like sex workers, etc. At that time, we were thinking sex workers or MSM population. I was working on hijras already because my topic for dissertation was pattern of STDs among the transsexual community. So I was working with them. So I said, these are the high-risk community we should work for, and medical caregiver, because unless until we create HIV awareness in medical caregivers, if and when the cases come, we will not be prepared. So we should have awareness in all the three communities, medical caregiver, high-risk community, and general population. And then have a clinic where examination of the patient which are suspected to come and self-report can be done. And thirdly, doing the testing, where the testing will be provided free of charge because kits were being provided free of charge by the Abbott laboratory at that time. We got government permission, next slide please. And we opened the India's first AIDS detection center, that was in 86, and next page, the full page right up in India today. And this was city's first AIDS clinic started. It was not city's, but it was country's first AIDS clinic. Later on we realized, because nobody started AIDS clinic anywhere. So this was clinic opening, and you can see me sitting next to the health ministers of Maharashtra. Next please. So what happened was, when HIV awareness started, there were a couple of HIV positives were detected also from Chennai, where passive surveillance was being done. And that time ICMR, Indian Council of Medical Research, were running a center from the CMC below. And those who tested, some of them who tested positive, that was declared in Parliament. However, the first clinical AIDS case was detected from the Jaslok Hospital, Mumbai. There was a patient who was already named at that time, Biharilal Makhija, who was under care of Dr. R.D. Lele, who was later honored with Padma Bhushan. And he clinically diagnosed that patient, who was a transfusion recipient patient for his heart surgery in USA. And he developed a unique kind of oral thrush and PCP pneumonia. So Dr. Lele called me. And he said, if you can come, please come and do some test which you are running free of charge. And we ran that test and it was positive. However, I was novice at that time. I was hardly 27 year old, and moreover, I was not a microbiologist, so I cannot comment on something which is test. So we called National Institute of Virology, and we sent the sample to the NIV Pune, and they also declared that it is HIV positive. Thereafter, some other tests were done, like CD4, that were that time done only in Tata Hospital, and one Dr. Sudha Gamble was there. She used to run also a test for beta 2 microglobulin. It was for cancer, but it could have been also run for HIV. All those tests were run from there, and they were found relevant, and some of the tests were found positive. And then it was declared on 10th of June 1986 that the first clinical AIDS case was diagnosed from Mumbai. With this, I approached Government of Maharashtra, and within a week's time, they said, okay, we should start an AIDS task force. And I was taken on the task force, and I was given a responsibility to invite a lot of other people on the task force. So Government of Maharashtra, particularly our health secretary at that time, Mr. D.T. Joseph, he was quite proactive. And so first case was diagnosed on 10th. On 11th itself, we started action. And on 17th, we had a first seminar at Government of Maharashtra headquartered in Mantralaya in Mumbai. So next slide, please. And as you know, in India, particularly in government sector, when you're working, if you do something extra, it is not liked by people. It is sometimes you are given some kind of punishment. And at that time, the punishment given to me, because I was talking to media, I was saying that there's AIDS. There are a lot of people will say, no, 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 AIDS, there's nothing like AIDS. Despite diagnosing first case, they said, no, no, that is a foreign, infection was from a foreign country. It is not indigenous. So I was given punishment posting, and at that time, punishment posting like going in the ambulance, which is escorting VVIP. And that time Rajiv Gandhi was visiting Mumbai, and I was put in the ambulance following Rajiv Gandhi's vehicle. And I thought, if I get a chance, I will talk to Prime Minister. But it was looking very difficult. But I carried a letter typed in the name of Prime Minister. Then our duty was over. Prime Minister was staying at that time in Taj Hotel in Mumbai. He was a very nice man, and he said that those people who helped me during the day, please come and talk to us. So he was sitting in a big law, suite in Taj Hotel. He's sitting with the Chief Minister, S.V. Chauhan, and he said, yes, you people all served me whole day. If you have anything to say. I was carrying a letter in my pocket, and I said, sir, I have a letter. What is it about? I said, sir, there is a possibility of AIDS in the city, but there is no activity here, apart from the clinic which is run as a one-man army. So with that letter, I approached him, and he asked immediately to the person sitting next to him, Mr. S.V. Chauhan, who was Chief Minister of Maharashtra. And S.B. Chauhan hardly knew anything at that time. He said, okay, don't worry, I will give you a note tomorrow morning. And I came back after my duty. Next day morning, I got a call from my dean's office that Chief Minister office called me, and they want you to write a note on AIDS. What is happening? What is the activity happening? So I wrote a note, and that note went from my dean to director to the secretary to the health minister to the chief minister. And next day there was a reaction. So you can see there was prime minister's concern over AIDS in city, and our memo to the prime minister. Next, please. And within 5 years, means 5 years activities were going on. And I said, okay, how many cases were there? And so many cases were increasing. And I said that India will top AIDS this decade. And this was in 1990 December. Because I realized that yes, there are so many cases. We are not doing enough testing. We are in denial mode largely. And actually speaking, India already hit the AIDS list in the global scenario in 1995. At the International AIDS Conference in Vancouver. the WHO, they had that time GPA, that is Global Program on AIDS. And they declared that India is number one in the world in HIV. Thereafter, now currently India is logging at number three, but it's number one, number two, number three is not a big issue, but India had a lot of HIV infection, that was a major issue. Next. During this entire period, we realized that blood safety is at stake because HIV testing was not done in the blood banks. Next time. This came to our notice that there was a whistleblower from All India Institute of Medical Sciences who raised the alarm because his wife was pregnant. His wife's blood group was O negative and his group was O positive. So he was to give some vaccine made out of blood, which is called anti-RHO vaccine. And because he was at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, it was 89, HIV awareness was already started in 85, and people knew that people who are blood donors, who are blood recipients or recipients of the blood, blood injections or blood vaccines, they could be at risk. So this person was a resident doctor. He tested that anti-RHO vaccine in his lab because he was from a microbiology department. To his dismay, he found that that blood product, which was made from some company from India, was already positive for HIV. And that was declared in the newspaper. At that time, that product was from some international organization. It was imported by India. So next day morning, it was in the headline that vaccine had AIDS antibodies. They stopped import of the vaccines. But nobody was going to the deeper portion, that who are the organizations which are manufacturing blood products. What I did was not to stop there. I went to the three blood manufacturing units, associated laboratories, Bharat Serum and Serum Institute of India in Pune. And we asked those laboratories, who are your blood donors? And they said, they are professional blood donors. So we went to some professional blood donors. We asked them to visit us in JJ Hospital and we wanted to check their blood so that we would know whether they are infected with HIV, hepatitis B, hepatitis C or not. That time, hepatitis C was not there. HIV, hepatitis B and syphilis. And we had about 200 of them coming to us. And we checked their HIV. Almost 70% of them were HIV positive. Then we checked their hepatitis B. Another 72-75% were hepatitis B positive. We checked for syphilis. Almost another 60-70% were syphilis positive. But if you try to apply HIV, hepatitis B or syphilis, either of them, almost 95% were either hepatitis B positive or HIV positive or syphilis positive. And many of them were two or three infections together. So it was such a shocking state for us. We took their detailed history. Where did you donate blood in last so many months or so many years? And how often you donate blood? To our dismay, they were donating blood three times in a month, three times a week. And they were going through plasmapheresis. That means they were donating blood, their plasma was removed, and they were given back the cell, or packed cell or red blood cell, along with the saline or glucose back to them so that they can come back again after 2 days and donate their plasma. This I had never heard earlier. So for me, it was shock. With all this information, where they donated blood, which other units they went, which blood bank they went, I filed a public interest litigation in Bombay High Court. Next slide. And one of the blood donors died. At that time, doctor was not willing to admit the patient. Doctors were not willing to admit the patient. With a lot of effort, I could get that patient admitted. Next slide, please. And then we realized that they were also not only stopping at donating blood, but they were also selling organs like kidney, eyes, or skin. And we had the paper presented at International AIDS Conference in Amsterdam. In 1992, this was also published in the Lancet magazine. And we filed a public interest litigation in Bombay High Court. In 1989, Bombay High Court ordered entire closure of all these blood manufacturing units. And blood banks, which were culprits. And thereafter, one by one, they opened, withdrawn. But they, Mumbai High Court made a child test compulsory in all the blood banks in Maharashtra, because the jurisdiction of Bombay High Court is only Maharashtra. And from 89 onwards, Maharashtra government started doing HIV test in all the blood banks in Maharashtra, whether the blood banks were in government or in private. But it took 9 years' time to make this case reach Supreme Court. In 1998, Supreme Court made it mandatory for the entire country to do HIV test. So it took 9 years' time for having HIV test in the entire country. Next slide. Thereafter, the major issue we faced was none of discrimination. And usually, we feel that discrimination can be by people who are illiterate. But to our dismay, it was by most intellectual people, mainly doctors. Next. So people were not even willing to touch patients with HIV. I used to manage patients from JJ Hospital, where I was a skin specialist and STD specialist. And in skin and STD department, there is no facility for delivery of treatment, there is no facility for blood transfusion, there is no facility for managing patients with neurological disorder. But because the doctors were not willing to take care of them in their respective departments, I started caring them in my department. But what I used to do, because I'm not a neurologist, I'm not a transfusion medicine person, and nor I'm a gynecologist. So first time I used to manage in whatever knowledge I had from my MBBS, because MBBS is Bachelor of Medicine and Bachelor of Surgery. Though I was not expert in gynecology, not MD in gynecology. But first time I used to do myself and used to call the people from gynecology or respective specialty and ask them to see how I'm managing, whether I'm right or wrong. And when they used to see me managing, they said, no, you are doing this way, please deliver the woman this way. I said, okay, why don't you come and help me? And they started helping me. And after that first case or two cases were over, I used to tell them, you can more efficiently manage that case from the gynecology department. So that hands-on training of how to touch patient, how to use gloves, how to use infection control precaution, and then they started doing it. Next, please. So it did not stop there. After my 10 years of change at JJ Hospital, I was not comfortable in working in government atmosphere. So I resigned from government service. I wanted to start private practice. I started that on 1st January 1992. On 2nd January, I was invited by the owner of the clinic. And he said, why don't you come and meet us? So I thought there must be some system of welcoming a doctor who is joining the polyclinic. Polyclinic had 18 other doctors. So I went there and they offered me a cup of tea in the evening. And they introduced me to everybody. And I said, okay, thank you very much. You're giving me a chance to meet and this and that. So the owner of the clinic said, doctor, it is not for welcoming you here. It is giving you a send-off. So I was shocked. What is the send-off? He said, you are HIV specialist. Other 18 specialists are objecting to your being here because they are thinking that you being HIV specialist, your patient will come and have using the same waiting area, which is a common waiting area. And if any of the patient gets HIV, they will blame us. So our polyclinic will stop functioning. I said, sir, how do you expect other people to get HIV from a common waiting area? He said, we do not know, HIV is quite new. He said, your waiting area is not a sexual encounter place. HIV is transmitted to many sex. So they said, no, nothing going, we don't know anything about HIV. You please vacate the place. This is your refund amount, your deposit and your monthly rental. We are not charging you for anything, you go. So the HIV clinic, which I started with a lot of fanfare, about 500, 600 visitors came, had to close down within a day. That was news again in the newspapers. There was news also in the Lancet that how the doctor was refused space in the practicing place. So it was not only discrimination of people living with HIV, it was also discrimination against the HIV physician. Next. But on my one hand, I don't have a place to sit and operate. On the other hand, a patient with HIV has a lot of questions. He may be homosexual, maybe bisexual, about using condoms, a suicidal tendency, how to deal with wife, whether to do masturbation, whether to do birth control. And all these things cannot be done single-handedly by me. So I needed a much larger space. I needed support of many people. I needed counselor, I needed staff. So fortunately, the news about my discrimination was in newspaper that was read by one of the philanthropists or a business person. And for some reason, I happened to visit him for his skin problem. And he said, are you the same doctor, Dr. Gillada, whose name came in the paper? I said, yes. So he said, I would like to offer you help and would you like to start some clinic of your own? And I said, yeah, sure. So second time when I went, he said, have you thought of that? Yes, I said, I thought of that. But I was not sure whether that person would help me because I never knew him. And only because I went to him for a skin problem through one of my common friends. Why should he help me invest so much big money? So third time when I went to him, he said, doctor, I think you are not interested in clinic. You just wanted to have some publicity. So it was publicity newspaper. I said, no, I'm serious. You tell me why you want to help me. And he said, no, I'm not trying to help you, but the clinic will be in my name. The property will be in my name. You run the clinic. And after my investment, if you do not get returns on the investment, then after a year or two, we'll say, okay, goodbye. But if you are able to run the clinics efficiently, I will not ask you money immediately, but whenever you can refund my money, please refund me. And that's the reason that my India's first AIDS clinic came to me. Next. So I was coming to stigma and discrimination, and we realized that stigma doesn't only hurt, it sometimes kills the people. Next, week, I can show you how people died. One of the HIV positive person who was a Bombay High Court advocate, his name was Mr. Sharma, and he was admitted in Bombay Hospital, and he was told by ward boy that you are HIV positive and tomorrow morning they will keep you out of the hospital. So early morning, next day, he committed suicide after jumping from 21st floor of the hospital. And we went demonstrating against that hospital. And you can see my younger daughter at that time. She was also joining us in the protest. Now she is a microbiologist. So we went, all of us, family and friends, at Bombay Hospital, had a demonstration that how can you allow what am I to disclose about HIV? And that time they had no policy of who should disclose, whether they should test or not. I'm talking about 1994. Next time. And this was our demonstration there. Next slide, please. And then we realized that not only that, within 1 week, that AIDS awareness week, 10 people committed suicide. So when the awareness goes up, then they are more and more discriminated. And those people who are with HIV or who are suspected with HIV, they committed suicide. So they were forced to take their lives. That much intensity was there about stigma and discrimination. Next slide. And we realized, after doing a survey and looking at some surveys, that at least 82% of the people living with HIV, they are faced with stigma and discrimination at least once in their life. Next one. Similarly, in 1989, one of the person who donated blood in a blood bank in Goa, after the Maharashtra government had that legislation of compulsory HIV test, even Goa started, because Goa is a very small state. Goa started doing the test, and in their blood bank, they found that somebody is HIV positive. And that HIV positive person, his name was Dominic D'Souza. The police was informed. Police went to that donor's place, just called him to the police station. And from the police station, he was taken to an isolation center. which was a tuberculosis sanatorium, and he was jailed there in that sanatorium because they didn't want to put him in a jail, suspecting that some other people could be also infected from that person. That person's mother, you see this woman, she was a nurse. And she went to the police station that my son had come here. Why did you release him? They said, you don't know what your son has done. Your son has infected somebody and we cannot leave him. So that person was put in that isolation. It was reported to us from Goa. His personal friend came. We had a press conference in Mumbai. I went from here along with my colleague, Mr. Ramashi. And we went and we wanted to stay at Dominic's place. Dominic's mother said, do you know, doctor, that my son is HIV positive? How can you stay at our home? I said, yeah, that's the reason we need to stay at your home, because by staying at your home, we are not likely to get HIV. So when we stayed at that home in a village called Para, which is near Mapsa in Goa, a lot of other community people came in. They wanted to meet me. But this is a village of a doctor from Mumbai, and he has come and he's staying at Dominic's place. And everybody in the community know that Dominic is HIV positive. So I convinced them that you do not get HIV by this way, that way, staying or sharing the toilet or sharing the eating place. So we coined some slogans, we made a lot of placard, and next day, all of them marched on the streets of Pune. And that was the first demonstration Goa had seen against AIDS. And the same day, we went to meet one of the MLAs, and one of the MLA was also a speaker of the assembly. He said, Dr. Gilada, you will spend your couple of days in meeting all the MLAs. Why don't you come and address us in assembly? And I will adjourn the house. So next day morning, I was called to the Goa Legislative Assembly. It was a rare honor for me to address the assembly and to speak to all the members of the legislature. So while speaking, the Chief Minister, Mr. Pratap Singh Dhane, was there. Head Minister, Mr. Dilip Biswa was there. During the talk, I said, if I'm carrying a HIV positive blood in the syringe from Mumbai, and I inject all of you, and tomorrow I demand, as per your Goa Public Health Act, that those who are suspected with HIV, they can be checked compulsorily, and those who are found positive, they should be isolated. So should you be isolated? And the health minister and chief minister said, no. So I said, why are you isolating Dominic? This one. He came and donated blood to do somebody's good. And just because he was checked and he was found positive, he is isolated. And they said, yes, this is wrong. And here is Dominic's mother and myself. And within a couple of weeks' time, they repealed the Goa Public Health Act. We, at the same time, filed a public interest litigation in High Court. So all these things, media, High Court of Mumbai, Goa bench, and the legislature and public movement, all of these four pillars of society that helped us see that Dominic is released and the whole Goa Public Health Act is repealed. Next slide. And there is a film made on Dominic's life called My Brother Nikhil. But as you know, the entire credit doesn't go to the people who really fight. So at that time, Anand Grover, who was advocate, he was not hired by us because he worked free for us, but we provided him airfare and hotel charge to stay in Panjim, and he fought free for us. And the entire credit was given to Anand Grover rather than naming me in that film. Next please. Then we started anti-discrimination movement during AIDS Awareness Week. So stop AIDS and stop discrimination. That was our story. Next slide. And now it has become a little easy because there are very good treatments available for HIV. So HIV positive person, he is or she is not stigmatized. They are looking as good as any other normal person. They are living the entire full life. So antiretroviral treatment has reduced the stigma related to HIV because they are part of society. Next. And Government of India also passed the law, which is called HIV/AIDS Act 2017, which is again having a provision for anti-discrimination and lot of pro-people living with HIV provisions in the law. So because of that, now people with HIV/AIDS cannot be discriminated anywhere, in job, in work, in workplace, or in medical care facilities, or even in insurance. Next slide. This is a Max Lupa insurance, where they were not earlier giving Medicaid policies, but now Medicaid policies can be given to HIV positive people. Next slide. And we made another initiative where HIV positive people, doctors, pharma companies, society, caregivers, they are all together, beating AIDS together. And with the slogan, Ye Jeevan Hai. So if you know the title song, Ye Jeevan Hai, Is Jeevan Ka Yahi Hai Rang Roop, Bade Kaante Thode Khushiyan. So there are good times, bad times. People with HIV may have some bad time, but it doesn't mean that they will not have good time. So that kind of meeting together, and we realize that this is another way to stop discrimination against HIV positive people, or honor them sometimes if they are living a very normal life. They have fared almost 25 years or 25 years along on ART. So that kind of situation is there now. Next slide. Then creating AIDS awareness is not a simple job. We need to have some innovations. And in innovation, we've seen a lot of newer techniques we use. Next slide. This HIV positive lady. Her story is moving. Even I can tell her story, but that will not make much of an impact. But if she comes and says, that will make an impact. So this is from Wadia Maternity Hospital, where we had a project to prevent mother-to-child transmission. And when she said how she was treated by doctors, among the doctors and nurses, it moved. She didn't want to come openly, so we provided her a mask. At that time, no mask were available, so on a cloth, we just made two holes so that she can see people and talk. Next slide. Then during the Ganesh festival, we knew that half of Mumbai, Pune, Maharashtra is on the streets. So if we use Lord Ganesha in giving message, that will be heard or seen more proactively than what I was doing or my organization was doing. So we said, at that time, Rajiv Gandhi was there as the Prime Minister, and he had a slogan called five-point program of Rajiv Gandhi, a five-point program of Prime Minister. So we devised that five-point program into HIV, and we said this five-point program to prevent HIV. And we said this is a Akhil Bharatiya AIDS Parishad, and these are the 5 points by which HIV can be prevented. And there is a dictum from Lord Ganesha, and that helped. A lot of people created awareness because of Lord Ganesha. And we created a slogan saying, Ab hame kuch karna hoga, bhakton ko AIDS se bachana. Next slide. And during the AIDS, during the Ganesh festival, on the last day, there is a Ganesh Visarjan. So during the Ganesh Visarjan, we carried a lot of condoms in van, distributed condoms in public, created HIV awareness, carried Lord Ganesha, showing that he is wearing a t-shirt of IHO, and he is telling Narad Muni, and Narad Muni is carrying the condom in his bag. So rather than Narad Muni, he is Nirod Muni here, telling people that go and tell people what is AIDS. And though I am celibate, I don't expect people to be celibate. Let people take precaution. So that created a lot of awareness. Next slide. So there are total unorthodox methods. Here at the Bhagavad Gita, religious discourse. Myself, Sunil Dutt was a film star, Dr. R.D. Lele, who diagnosed first AIDS case, German consulate, we went and we created AIDS awareness through the person was a Rushi or a person who was giving discourse on Gita. And that created greater impact. Next slide. And all our methods and unorthodox method like carrying garland of condom. This was a condom garland, talking through my microphone, which was condomized. And this was published on Washington Post on 22nd September 1992 on front page. So from front page to inside, almost 1.5 pages. And then the UCSF chief came, president of the international society came. They wanted to see our work. They visited this area. So a lot of international pull and push was also used at that time. Next slide. We did street plays in public places. We did exhibitions in public places like radio stations and bus stops. Next please. We had AIDS march involving NCC, NSS, and a lot of students ongoing marching from a lot of overcrowded places with the AIDS symbol. At that time, we used to call AIDS Rakshas or AIDS Dinosaur or different, because at that time there were no treatments available. So it was a big hoa that AIDS, if it comes, it will be kind of a death. And it was sounding easy, but very difficult to create awareness in people. But we did that. Next slide. And now we have a lot of social media. So during those days to these days, a lot of innovations every time we have to have. Next slide. A jam-packed hall among students. We have to catch them young. So like you people, if HIV awareness is done in you people, it will go to your peers, it will go to you for entire life. So it is very important that in young people or young population, we create awareness where they have not yet changed the habits. Once the habits are changed, it's very, very difficult to change the habits. So whether it's for drugs, whether it's for alcohol, whether it's for smoking, tobacco, or HIV/AIDS, we need to create awareness as early as possible. Next slide. Here, you can see we use also mobile clinic approach. Mobile clinic will go with the public honking made of AIDS. It's too big to ignore that kind of big slogans. Mobile clinic park, people will come and see what is happening. We create awareness, we distribute condom, we do a group meeting. Thereafter, there will be question and answer session. And thereafter, those who are suspecting themselves or they should be tested, they will come in the van and we'll do the testing. Based on the same thing, there is now COVID-19 testing van started in Mumbai and Pune by one of the Jain groups. So this is a very simple approach of going to the community and telling people, be good. If you cannot be good, be careful. In any case, be informed. Next slide. Then we realize that smallest of the small parties, they are known everywhere. How they are known? Because they do electioneering campaign. They write slogans all over the country. They have election symbol. And through symbol and slogan, they become famous all over the country. So why can't we reach in the same way to people? So we find good slogans. And we captured a lot of walls in Mumbai on the streets as well as on the railway tracks. And I hired a painter from my hometown. And I used to pay him 25 rupees per wall, which will include the color and his labor. And all the walls were free of charge to us because we are doing public campaign. So slogans like, Kisi ki mohabbat bhari baaton mein mat aao, magar nigar ki gairon ke saath mat jao. गैरों के साथ सेक्स अब नहीं, विरोध के बगैर कभी नहीं, आजाद आजाद देश की सही पहचान, एड्स मुक्त हिंदुस्तान, निरोध है जहां एड्स नहीं वहां. सो दैट काइंड ऑफ स्लोगन एंड रीच आउट टू पीपल एट अ वेरी लो कॉस्ट. नेक्स्ट स्लाइड. सो यू कैन इमेजिन 1000 वॉल प्रिंटेड ओनली फॉर 25,000 रुपीज एंड मिलियंस ऑफ पीपल कुड बी मेड अवेयर. देन वी इन्वॉल्व सेलिब्रिटीज. नेक्स्ट स्लाइड. You can see here Kumar Gaurav, his wife Namrata Dutt, that is Sunita's daughter. Next slide, please. Kiran Shantaram, here British Nandi, US Consul General. Next slide, please. Jackie Shroff, and the child with HIV and mother with a mask. Next slide, please. Sunil Dutt used to be our constant support. He was president of People's Health Organization until his death. And he used to come for our AIDS awareness campaign. So you can see that he is pulling the bullock cart rather than a bull pulling the bullock cart, and he is the AIDS noxious or AIDS bad. So next slide. Also, Sunil Dutt carrying HIV positive child in arm. So that message goes loud and clear that you do not get HIV by touching HIV positive people. Next slide, please. Then we started sex workers intervention project right in 1989. Next slide, please. It was Project Saheli. Initially, they were not interested to know about HIV AIDS. And the first World AIDS Day in 1989, was December 89. When I went with a box of 5,000 condoms, I could not distribute 5 condoms. And then I realized that those people who should be using condoms, like clients from the sex worker, they are not interested. Nobody wants to use it. So we focused the campaign on the red light area. We started a Project Saheli. Our idea was that sex workers work under different hierarchical system. Their brother owner at the top level, brother manager at the middle level, brother girls at the lower level. So we must create awareness in all the three groups. And with that kind of system, we launched the Saheli project, provided them some incentive, incentivizing money for their time, training them, educating them. And you can see, I was going with the Gandhana condom. Here is a sex worker who is called Saheli. He's putting a banana in her hand, putting condom on banana, trying to educate people. Next slide. Even mobile clinic had a mobile exhibition. I was distributing condom. We're doing demonstration outside the red light area. Next slide, please. And then the demonstration started by sex workers themselves, by sex worker for the sex worker. And they were convincing the sex worker that it is very important for them to use condom. He could impress upon them that you earn your livelihood by saving your life. And you spend almost one third of money in upkeep of your health. If you use condom, you will not get sick, you will not die, you will not get STDs, you need not go to doctors. And sometimes it is okay to refuse a client who is not willing to come without condom, without condom. So you refuse the client, but use condom. And that became a rule, no condom, no sex became a rule. And that Saheli project was replicated in several cities in the country. As well as even neighboring countries like Pakistan and Bangladesh, though we don't share our good relationship with a lot of countries, but the project went there and the project was very well received, and Kolkata Sonagachi project became world famous after one Saheli project. Next slide. So Saheli project went from there to having a Saheli conference. So rather than having only doctors conference, we had a Saheli conference in Surinder. And here, Kunika, one of the film stars, they came to inaugurate the Saheli conference. Next slide. Then we had a program called Raksha Bandhan. And every time we used to go, me and Sunita, and a lot of, we were taking to Raksha Bandhan of those sex workers from HIV/AIDS. Next slide. Linda Evangelista, one of the supermodel, she visited Red Light area. So that Red Light area became a place where a lot of celebrities were coming to visit us in our project. Next time. And now, we did not stop there. Two of the sex workers were leading the AIDS march, which was followed by other people. So they became the leader for creating AIDS awareness in the country. Next time. The first comprehensive HIV care clinic in private sector was started by me in 1995. As I said, that Mr. Ramesh Chukhani was good enough to offer me support, and this clinic started. Next slide. And that was 5th of February 1995. Najwa Abdullah, who is now governor of Manipur. At that time, she was a deputy chairperson of Rajya Sabha. So in that, they came and inaugurated the clinic. Next time. And on the similar lines, we started the clinic, Hope's Clinic in Lucknow, Hope's Clinic in Goa. So that became a replicable model. Next time. Then we realized that looking at National AIDS Program, something is amiss, which is HIV prevention, which has taken a backseat. Next. So if you look at the current scenario, the HIV has started decreasing. Right from say 1998 till 2014 or 15, it is every year going down, down, down. But it might go up again because we are not doing enough for prevention. Next. So if you look at the National AIDS Program, the first part, 1992 to 1999, was intervention, initial intervention. Thereafter, decentralization of states, limited coverage of services, and launch of ART program. So in 2004, after they launched the ART program, their entire HIV awareness program, intervention among sex workers or high-risk behavior people, that has taken a backseat. Because that has taken a backseat, we may see on the spot of HIV infection in the country. Next slide. So what is required in HIV prevention? There are a lot of things which are required. It is not merely use condom preventives. You require male condom, you require female condom, you require treatment of STIs. Is male circumcision that can reduce HIV transmission by almost one third? There is a couple, one is not. You treat one positive, the other person can be automatically prevented. Behavioral change modification, oral prayer, whereby giving preventive medicine or antiretroviral therapy, if that is given as a prevention called pre-exposure prophylaxis, after exposure, it can be post-exposure prophylaxis, it can be there. You can have vaccine, the vaccine is not available, but a lot of things are there. Next slide. So you can see different sizes of condom, different types of condom, different colors of condom. There are thick condom for homosexual population. So people didn't know till we started major awareness that there could be so many types of condom. Next slide. And it was also invented to have a female condom. Female condom is an invention thanks to HIV. So when we blame the virus, we have to thank the virus. There are a lot of new things which has come after HIV has come. Next slide. As I was telling you, PrEP, the pre-exposure prophylaxis, a single tablet can prevent HIV infection. If you are taking the PrEP daily, you can continue to have a high risk behavior activity, HIV will not be transmitted. Even if you are exposed to HIV, it will not be tested. Then we're looking at current status and target of 1990. That means 90% of the people who have HIV, they should know their status. 90% of those people who are with HIV, who they should be put on antiretroviral therapy. 90% of the people who are on antiretroviral therapy, they should have their virus load controlled. So by achieving this target by 2020, we can achieve 70% of the target. That is 90% of 90% of 90% that comes to 70%. And yet, we have not achieved this target because this target was to be achieved by 2020. We are just 9 months away from, or 7 months away from the target. In between, COVID has come. So people will not be much interested in HIV. So that target will be unfulfilled and might take another year or 2 hours. Next. Government of India has started a mission called Mission Sampa. Those people who are lost to follow, who are on ART, but they did not take ART for the last couple of months or so, they are trying to be contacted and then they're going to come back. Next slide. There's also preventing mother to child transmission, and they want to have eliminated these mother, even if mothers are infected, it's not a single child will be infected. And that elimination program is started by Government of India. Earlier, it was half of the mothers, those who were tested, they were not coming back to take reports, so they were not taking on ART also. Next slide. The Government of India is also expanding ART center to all the medical colleges, whether they're government or private. So 198 Royal Medical Colleges will be part of ART Center. Next. There are operational conceptual issues. There is a supply chain management, sometimes stockouts are there. There is a staff selection, retention, training at ART centers. ART officers are not well paid, so they are not interested, they are not well trained, they need to be groomed. The finances, when everything is free, because currently ART is free, ACD4 is free, wire load is free, where do we stop? Now what will happen with COVID? Government of India will be bankrupt, government of Maharashtra will be bankrupt, government of UP, MP will be bankrupt. Where do the people go? So how do we recover the money? So that issue will be there. Home-based testing is not a great strategy. Pre-marriage checkup, that should be health checkup, not merely HIV. So HIV, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, blood group, diabetes, syphilis, and stringent linkages when they are found positive in blood bank. They should be linked to the care, whether it is HIV or hepatitis B or hepatitis C, therefore triple H. Sometimes we are going back. It's not only HIV which is killer in HIV positive people. More than 50% people in HIV people, they are dying of non-HIV illnesses. That could be liver disease, that may be because of alcohol, that may be injection drug related diseases, it's because of smoking, because of cardiovascular diseases. So we need to also look at other diseases to reduce the mortality or morbidity in HIV positive people. Next slide. There's a shortage of HIV experts. The entire country of 1.4 billion people, we don't have more than 100 full-time qualified and trained HIV physicians. And that is number, that number is stagnant, it's not growing. We need to do something very serious. Next slide. Then there are some infections that can be prevented. And now everybody is looking at COVID vaccine. COVID vaccine may come within a couple of months or so. People may take because they are scared of COVID. But people do not take even those vaccines which are easily available. They are at very low cost, like hepatitis B vaccine, available for $1 or $2 or 50 or 100 rupees. People are not taking it. So what is the use of talking about HIV vaccine or COVID vaccine? Government of India has done some game changes, that is test and treat policy, that every HIV positive person, as soon as he's detected, is put on treatment. There's also HIV AIDS Act, which was delayed by several decades, that has been passed in 2017, as I said. Wire load facility was not available in government for routine, that they started in 2018. Next slide. So now there is a rationale of integrated monitoring and evaluation system and differentiated care delivery, where a lot of people, they are they are coming to ART center. They throng ART center. But many of them are not sick. The ART is so nice, so good. So why they should come to ART center just to take ART medicine? So they can go to the link center or community center. And they should come to the ART center only if they are sick, or they should come once in 3 months for periodical checkup. So, and only those people which are having medical problems like TB or pneumonia, etc., they should be going to the ART center, so they will be fast track. Reduce the load on ART center by almost 70% if we provide medicine for 2 to 3 months or 4 months. Next slide. Government of India is now able to provide medicine free of charge. Many of the governments in the world are able to provide free of charge. President's program of USA, that is called COFAR, they are using Indian medicine. Why? Because initially, international medicine, which was 3-in-1 combination, it was $10,439 per patient per year. And one of the company from India, Cipla, they could provide that medicine, bringing them the cost to $350, $1 per day. Now, the lowest quoted cost is $69 per year. That is $70 into 70, that is 4,000 or 5,000 rupees per patient per year. So the cost has come down so heavily, and that's the reason that India is in the storm of eye of people internationally, because we defied patents, we are able to reach out to people all over the world. Currently, 92% of the world's HIV positive people, they are taking HIV medicine made from India. Next one. Another gift of India to the rest of the world is 3-in-1 combination of medicine. Initially, people with HIV were taking, you can count how many medicines they used to take per day. 18 plus 4, 24, 22 medicine. Only for HIV. We are not talking about vitamin, etc., which are required, or TB medicine, which are required. Then that became 4 tablets per day. Then that became 2 tablets per day. India made 1 tablet per day. All medicine together. This has been taught to us by TB. Because all 4 medicines can be combined in TB. Why can't HIV medicine be combined together? So India has combined, entire world followed. When we copied the West for their patents, we are called copycats. But when they are copying us on 3-in-1 medicine, they never ever acknowledge that we have learned this technique from India. Next. Intellectual property right, now they are also compromising. They are the partnership project where people can take medicine from there is a medicine patent pool where the patent program companies can donate patent to that MPP. MPP can give that patent to the generic companies, and generic companies can manufacture at low cost and sell to the companies or to the organizations or countries which are not in the patent regime. Patent regime like Western Europe, Australia, New Zealand, Canada, US, they can afford very high cost, but we cannot afford. So this is the international body now, come under the United Nations, NPP. Next slide. What is the way forward? Next one. We have to end AIDS by 2030. And in sustainable development goals, there are 6 goals. Goal 3, 4, 5, 10, 16, and 17. They cover openly or covertly HIV-related issues. So where you can see that universal health coverage is there for HIV, you can see that empowerment of people living with HIV is there, you can see that women should be given support or empowerment should be done, young people. So to achieve even SDGs of United Nations, we need to achieve the 6 goals which are related to HIV. Next slide. We need to converge people as that is hepatitis B, HIV, hepatitis C, and TB. We need to have better pay scale for ART officer. We need to have cost sharing approach like Tata Hospital, where 40% are private, 40% general, low cost and 50% totally free. Percentage can be different in different sector. Develop generic workload kits. We are all talking about now generic PCR test for COVID. Had we done the generic workload kits for HIV, that technology could have been used here. The generic registration test, optimize healthcare spending, introduce smart card system. These all would have been helped. Now we are talking about the app, Arogya Setu. If this was done earlier, it could have been part of, COVID could have been part of that. Any new disease can be part of that. It was not done earlier. So at least COVID is teaching us a lot of things now. Prioritization of sex workers, MSM or IDA, because they are a disadvantaged population. Next slide. We have to have different vertical program like revised national TB program or central TB program. We should come together. We cannot have vertical structures now. Even national viral hepatitis control program started. That should be part of together. You have a triple H program or you have viral hepatitis program together with the Chinese. Optimally use infrastructure and resources. You cannot have different directors and different programs. There hardly any work is there for each director. So why don't we one director be for 3, 4, 5 programs? So we need to look at that. And your IIM can come in to rescue for that. Next slide. So to develop this end AIDS 2030 strategy. We conducted a program just recently, and there are a lot of people internationally also trying to support this. Next slide. See, strategies have to keep evolving. We always give three monkeys, 1, 2, 3. In the era of HIV, we brought in fourth monkey here, who we call extension of Gandhi's philosophy for 21st century. And if you don't like ART and spend on it, prevent HIV this way. But now in COVID era, even this will not help. So you must have a mask. Next slide. Another extension. I would like to thank you people. I'd like to thank my patients. They've been a great source of inspiration to me. Thank you, WHO, ENS, and MSF for the data and graphics. Several scientists and clinicians and therapists with whom I interact on a daily basis. CNS, especially Shobha Shukla and Mr. Bobby Ramakar. They have been a great support to us, not only for this program, but all around the year. And this is a public-private partnership. The private to public, public to private, public to public, and private to private. And these are Indian at heart and global in spirit. So we need to look at that, and all of you for your dark attention. Thank you. I think my last slide is there. Is there something? Or this was the last? Oh, thank you. Sorry if I overshot by a couple of minutes. I tried to look at that. Yes, 5 minutes no shot.
Many thanks, Dr. has taken us down history lane of India's long fight against HIV/AIDS. We now open for a Q&A session, and participants, please raise your virtual hand to ask your questions. That is the best to do, or type in your question in the chat box, because I have a very weak connection at my end. So I hope it will be, I think it is best if you ask the question. So yes, over to the participants. I'm sure you must. And I would request Bobby to help with this, because I'm really struggling with a very weak internet connection.
Dr. Sahib, where HIV services affected during...
We have a question. Yes, Dr. Gilada. Sorry.
I can hear that. Very good question. And Shivaji and Bobby... We witnessed it to a great extent. They were compromised
during because, COVID pandemic, and are HIV positive people more at risk of COVID?
Chana, what better? Super one. As the professor said, one is difficult to be. One minute.
Yes, Dr. Gilada.
Services were affected because the one was started very much haphazard. And though they said that courier system, couriers will work, speed post will work, they were not functioning. To my dismay, at one of the speed post center, there was a board, Gangajal Yahan Milega. I think they also sell Gangajal at speed post offices. But speed post was not there. So I fought with them. I said, you are not doing the job you should have been doing. Then I spoke to the very high official in speed post in Maharashtra. And thereafter, at least speed post is accepting the medicines. We have to write medicines, lifesaver, or emergency medicine, lifesaver. And they are going, though they take 7 to 10 days time. Then at some places, they were not able to access to even speed post or courier. So we talked to the National AIDS Control Organization, NACO, and we asked them, can they supply free medicine to the private patients? And they were very kind enough to issue that order, that during the entire lockdown period, they will be able to provide free medicine at their AIT center. The only thing was that they may not be able to give the matching medicine. Yes, next question.
Do you think that there has been a sort of complacency around HIV prevention interventions, or people are more complacent about it now, thinking that there is a they can live a healthy life even with HIV?
About HIV complacency or COVID?
No, HIV complacency.
HIV now, complacency has gone because of two, three things. One is HIV has become quite a normalized infection. Only stigma remains is stigma related to sex, or sex with multiple partners, or sex with male, sex with male, or bisexual, or sometimes even heterosexual, but people do not want to inform their family. So that stigma will remain. And they try to camouflage, they try to remove the label of the medicine. They say we are taking vitamin or something. But apart from that, the stigma related to their disease or being sick or losing weight or having diarrhea or getting tuberculosis or getting some kind of marks because of lipodystrophy or lipoatrophy, those things are not there. And that, because of that, people are now coming forward. That complacency which was there earlier, it is no more there. We never knew HIV.
Okay.
I was born, oh yeah. You born in a very good era, except that the COVID.
Thank you. Parv wants to ask a question.
You are not seeing very big problems like we are seeing or our grandparents are seeing.
Parv Julania wants to ask a question. Yes, Parv. Parv, you wanted to ask a question?
Thank you. Anything else, Shivani?
Yeah, one more question I wanted to know.
Yeah.
You are still involved with the sex workers and you are continuing AIDS awareness programs with them in Mumbai?
We are involved through People's Health Organization only in Pune. We don't have any people in Mumbai because two things. There are a lot of other people who started working. Number two, sex workers have reduced drastically, almost by 90% in Mumbai, and thirdly, we don't have any grant. So our major project only about sex workers is in Pune, Sahedi, where we have been able to develop a role model of Sahedi is running the Sahedi project. Except one project manager from our side, there is nobody who is working, which is done. So all our
series are running the same. Okay. We have a question from Saida Deep. She says that, sir, we never knew HIV stigma as I was born in 1993. But when you were speaking about AIDS stigma back then, I was reminded of the stigma of COVID-19 which we are facing today. Are we going back in some ways? Because these days we are hearing a lot of news about a stigma around COVID-19.
So, what is the question about COVID-19 and what?
COVID-19, yes. There are a lot of stigma around patients with COVID-19. We have been hearing that even burials are not being allowed, and they are not allowing people to come to their houses, even doctors who are working in COVID, working with COVID-19 patients.
You see, I will tell you.
Yes.
A lot of stigma is man-made, and a lot of stigma is contagion-made. Initially, there was a stigma for tuberculosis and leprosy. Leprosy stigma was because of contagion. People used to think that by touch, you can get leprosy. And it took a long time. Thereafter, the stigma came for HIV, but HIV stigma was due to sexual activity. If HIV was through droplet infection or through something else, the stigma would not have been there. The stigma was because it is a double standard culture in India, in Indian society, that you do everything but do not talk about it. The stigma in COVID is because it is again contagion. And moreover, initially we put a lot of big hoarding everywhere in the city or country that don't be scared of COVID. Well, don't be scared, then why are you putting so many big, huge billboards? That means you should be scared. So you're talking one thing and doing something else. And then currently we are not sure whether COVID can be transmitted through droplet or it can be transmitted through small particles or even aerosol. So if it is transmitted through aerosol, then the air we are breathing, after somebody has had a cough who is having COVID, I can pick up COVID. So that is a major problem, major concern. And and secondly, we are saying whether community transmission is there or not. But there are people who are getting COVID without having to travel to abroad, without having any kind of travel history or having a COVID at family or somebody known circle, getting from somewhere in society. So that is a stigma related to contagion. And that might continue to happen for a long time.
Okay. Now, participants, your last chance to ask any question or any comments, because we have already overshot the time by many, many minutes. And Dr. Gelada, just one from you. It's always so inspiring to listen to you. So one inspiring take-home message from you before we end.
I think be responsible, stay home, stay connected through web, work from home as far as possible, make your elderly people much more safe, because very good thing about COVID currently is it is not a very big killer in India. The death rate in India is not as much as in Western countries, and we can still bring it down. So if we are able to bring down death to say 1% or less than 1%, then it will not be a very big issue. Then, okay, you got COVID, you got rid of COVID. That's it. So, looking at the death, most of the deaths are in elderly people, those which are above 60 or 65, or above 80, is nearly 100%. So you protect those people which are at home, or those which are elderly. Even I am 62, so I'm in that kind of borderline. So people like us should be protected more, and young people should keep on working upfront. But nothing can be done from home. None of things can be done online. So now it is going to be going to change the entire medical practice also. So I think we should be able to propagate to your institution how practice can be done online.
Okay. Thank you very much. With this, we come to the end of today's discussion. And we will be meeting again on Wednesday, May 6th at 1:30 p.m. to listen to John Jandai from Thailand on self-reliance and sustainable living. Bye till then and stay safe. And our sincere thanks once again to Dr. Gelada.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. On the behalf of IMDO.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much.